fat, not your weight. Okay, now anybody can tell me why I've chosen this topic?
Because you look slim.
It's a hot cake today,
and I wanted something which would grab eyes.
Oh, I have come because of the other way around.
Gain weight. Okay. I think there are very few lucky people. But then let me tell you, losing weight or whatever is much easier than gaining weight. I mean, I've had clients, you know, when it's losing weight, it's like you can assure them within a week they start seeing results. But when it's gaining weight, it's like 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, sometimes they get frustrated. Then you tell them, you know, it'll take a month, 2 months. It's a very slow
process.
I don't
see it necessarily. But they say according to your height, your body weight.
Yeah, that's a different thing.
Sometimes it's disqualified because your body weight is much less than your height.
Okay. So, now what is lose fat, not your weight? Like he said, it's a hot cake and everybody is obsessed with this weight loss thing, you know. But the thing is, what exactly is weight loss? Could someone explain this statement, lose fat, not your weight?
See, the muscle mass needs to remain.
Yeah, very good.
It's the adipose that has added to that extra unwanted weight.
Yes.
That needs to be removed.
Good.
Huh?
Yeah, but I think he's one of the few people who knows the difference, you know. But most people just think of weight loss. When they go to the gym, when they feel they want to lose weight, when they want to shape up, they measure their results every day by looking at the scales, which is actually a wrong thing. You know, if you keep seeing a change in your weight every day, that means something is going wrong. In fact, there are people who are so obsessed. No, not psychologically, physiologically, it's not going the right way.
Fat seen around the world.
Yeah, that's true. How would you describe a person?
A healthy person is a
healthy person. Okay, healthy. What do you mean by healthy body?
Is diabetes, is blood pressure and sugar under control.
That's it? That's all that is the criteria for deciding if a person is fit?
And he's mentally alert.
Okay. That's all part of it. But how would you kind of say it in a nutshell?
He looks fit.
Fit and
he
fine.
He looks fit, okay. Even I look fit, but I'm not 100% fit.
There are a lot of factors.
There are a lot of factors.
BMI and other this thing.
Oh no, BMI actually is a wrong thing. Yeah, it's a wrong indicator. Okay. Now the five components of fitness. One is cardiovascular endurance, muscular endurance, musculoskeletal strength, flexibility and ideal body composition. Now this, of course, we'll quickly go through it. What I'm going to focus on is this ideal body composition. Okay. Now cardiovascular endurance is a person who can walk for a long time, you know, his heart rate, his heartbeat will go according to his pace. Muscular endurance is, you know, like when you're doing something like swimming, you know, where your muscles also come into the picture. So that is your muscular endurance. Musculoskeletal strength is when you're working out in the gym. If you can lift heavy, that is your musculoskeletal strength. Flexibility is, of course, when you bend and stretch. And your ideal body composition. Now, ideal body composition is where we talk about your fat and your muscles. So if you pass all these five tests, then you are regarded as a completely fit person. Now let's talk about a case study one. Now there are four men. Okay, we call them A, B, C, D. They're all of the same height, 5 feet 5 inches. Now according to calculations, according to their height, their body weight should be 60 kgs. Now here you have A, whose body weight is 56, B weighs 59, C is 70, and D is 75. Now according to this, what I've given you, how would you rate them? Who would be overweight, underweight, fit?
D would be C.
You can't say.
Okay, let them say. Okay, according to them, I've given them the weight, so according to that, they've decided B is fit. Obviously, C and D are overweight because they are way off the mark. And A is obviously underweight. Okay?
The body frame also comes into account.
Exactly, of course.
So if you have the small frame, medium frame,
exactly,
or the broad frame.
Of course.
But then this criteria will
This criteria
change.
Is wrong, but a lot of people go by this criteria. Yeah. You know, they want to be... Yeah, they want to get into that ideal body weight, not realizing is it, you know, in this accordance with their body structure.
So 59 to 70 should be okay.
Then 56.
Again, it depends. It depends.
56 is also a marker.
Okay. Now, let's come to body composition. Okay. We'll come to that case study again a little later. Now, when I say body composition, it's mainly two things. Lean body mass and your fat. Now, everybody knows what is fat in the body. We all regard it as an unwanted part of our body, which again we'll touch upon later. Now, lean body mass, like I said, besides fat, everything else in the body is lean body mass. So that includes your muscles, your bones, your tissues, the blood, fluid, everything else, teeth, skin, everything else is your lean body mass. Okay? Now, body fat, like we said, is, we normally regard fat as unwanted, adipose tissue unwanted. Now, it is in certain quantities, it is required. Okay? So, for men, the 10 to 15% of body weight has to be fat. For women, 15 to 20% of body weight has to be fat. Now, if you exceed this, then your ideal body composition changes. Now, for men, if I say 10 to 15% is body fat, so what should the remaining 85 to 90% be?
What are also there apart from this?
What is body composition? Lean body mass and fat.
Yeah.
So 15%, exactly, 10 to 15% is fat, so the remaining 85 to 90% should be your lean body mass. That is your muscle, like you said, water, everything else in the body, okay? Similarly, for women, lean body mass has to be around 80 to 85%. So if you have that composition, then you come under the ideal body composition.
And the fat increase, then you get things like...
We'll come to this. Now, types of body fat. Now, there are two types of body fat. See, one, what we are going to talk about today is that subcutaneous and the visceral fat. Then there is one which is essential, which you don't even have to think about, you know, which is there in your cell walls, which has to be there. Okay, that is the bare minimum which has to be there. Now, what goes wrong with your diet or your lifestyle is contributing, it contributes to this fat. Your subcutaneous fat, that is your fat just below the skin. Okay, now this makes a person look thin or fat. Then you have your visceral fat, which is surrounding your, vital organs, like your heart, lung, kidneys. If you have a fall, something has to cushion these organs, you know. So there's visceral fat is around these organs. But if it exceeds beyond a certain limit, then that visceral fat is dangerous. Like you just said, it can cause various diseases. Like, you know, especially if you're up in the abdomen, all your vital organs, most of them are there in the abdomen. Now, if that visceral fat increases, then you are you have a lot of problems like diabetes, hormonal problems, thyroid, of course, hormonal problems, cardiovascular diseases, high BP. So you are susceptible to all these things. Now, your subcutaneous fat, like I said, is just cosmetic. Of course, if you have too much of subcutaneous fat, your first thing that will be affected will be your knee joint. Okay, so that way it can cause a health problem, your knee joint problem. Otherwise, it just makes a person look fat and obviously he's going to be inactive and all the other things that follow with being overweight. Okay, but your visceral fat is what has an immediate connection with your problems, with your with various diseases. Now, this is just your reference in case you're interested. Now, just below the navel. If you measure your abdominal circumference, you know, for men, if it's greater than 90 or 35 inches, and for women, if it's greater than 80 centimeters or 31 inches, that means you are susceptible to various cardiovascular diseases. It's an indicator. You could. So the idea is, it has to be below that. You have to maintain that visceral fat with your diet and lifestyle.
But for a tall person, 35 inches, that could be ideal.
No, but how?
Waist.
No, we're talking about the waist. No, why would he have a broad waist like that? See, even if his body structure is that way.
Yeah.
But then when you measure it, it would be in sync, you know?
Yeah.
So that is an indicator.
Approximately.
That's an indicator that your fat is above, you have to do something about it. Otherwise, you could be. You could have any of these cardiovascular problems, any disease.
You roll out the role of genetics.
Genetics ultimately is 80%. 20%. 80% is what we do with ourselves. You know, it's very easy for people to say, my father was fat, my mother was fat, so even I'm fat. That's just 20% you inherit from your parents. The rest of the 80% you can play around with. Okay, now we come back to our case study of A, B, C, D, where we said A was underweight, B was, what did we say? B was fit, no?
Fit.
Because he was closer to that 60 mark. And C and D were overweight.
C also is fit.
Okay, now I have given you their fat percentage. Now how would you rate them?
Except for 70 kgs.
C's fit body.
C. Except for C.
C is actually a fit person.
Fit.
Yes, yes. He is fit because his fat percent is exactly
15%.
Okay, even though he weighs 10 kgs.
15%.
So even if he weighs 70 kilos, which is 10 kilos in excess of his ideal body weight, that is okay. He could be a bodybuilder with good muscle mass. You know, when your muscles always are heavy, they make you weigh more. But if your fat percentage is 15%, you will never look out of shape. Alright? Now, A, according to this, A and B are unfit. But problem is, if someone just checks the weight, which most people do, he would be told you have to gain weight. B would be told you are just about okay.
Yeah.
C would be told you have to lose weight. Poor guy, I mean, he's got a good body composition, but he will go on a weight, if he's not educated, I mean, if he doesn't know, he would go on a weight loss and probably lose muscles and gain fat. And same with D. D, of course, anyway, has to, is overweight and obviously extra fat percent. So now you know the difference between what is the criteria, more than the weight, it is the fat percentage. And how do you measure fat percentage? How would you know what is this person's body fat percentage?
We have some machines nowadays.
Yeah, a lot of gyms have that machine. One is a handheld machine. Of course, it gives you an approximate indication.
Yeah.
It's not an example. At least you know where you are. Then you also have this thing where you stand on it and you also hold it, which is a little more accurate. Okay, so that gives you an entire breakdown, how much water content in your body, how much lean body mass, your bone mass, everything it gives you. So you get an idea of where you are.
What do you call that machine?
It's a bio-electrical impedance,
impedance,
I-M-P-E-D-E-N-C. And of course, if you go to the major hospitals like the Ambani and all that, they have the DEXA, which gives you an accurate measure. You know exactly, it's through X-rays. So DEXA gives you exactly how much lean body mass, how much fat you have. It gives you a proper breakup and a very accurate indicator. Plus calcium deficiency, everything else. Everything, yes. So the DEXA, of course, but it's very expensive. DEXA, D-E-X-A.
What is that machine like?
I think in some of the, it has got this panel.
I have
and
not
all
seen the machine, but it's a very expensive test also.
And then you have to put your hand or something.
It's through X-rays. So it's much more accurate. But of course, the major hospitals would have it, like probably Hinduja, Hiranandani, and Kokilabhen, you know, these kind of hospitals. And of course, it's probably costs about 3 or 4 grand for that test. It's an expensive test. Now, when we come to fat loss and weight loss, now what is the difference? Tell me, if I say my, let's come back to the headline, lose fat, not your weight. So what is it trying to say?
This visceral and other fat you
can... Yeah, visceral fat you cannot control as such. Of course, you can control, but you cannot make out as such. But then basically, what is the take home message?
You keep your lifestyle, your weight training and other this thing, aiming to lose that fat, not your weight.
Okay, good. And how would you determine, every day you can't keep measuring your fat percentage, because you'll never, how would you measure that you are going on the right track? That you are losing fat, not muscles, how would you measure, how would you gauge?
Looking at
you will
not feel
see,
as much exhausted as
that could be the effect of exercise also. That could be the just the physiological, psychological effect of workouts. Also, probably if you're working out, you're probably eating better than what you are eating otherwise. You're not eating junk food. That is true, but how would you kind of gauge your results? Your clothes will start feeling, little
looser.
Your clothes start feeling looser, of course. You start feeling better, of course. That is a given. Alright, you start, and of course if you check your weight after a week, 10 days, you may see there's no change in your weight. Some people actually get worried, huh? They say there's no change in my weight, you know, but their clothes are feeling better.
But changes in this area.
Yeah, all your sleeves, everything, they say you see that this top was tight for me, it's getting loose. So that effect.
And the weight is the same.
The weight is the same, so then these people get worried because they don't realize, you know, that weight is not such an important criteria. It's ultimately your inch loss, that is your fat loss, which is important. Okay, so whenever you're losing fat, you tend to lose a lot in inches. You may or may not lose weight. You will lose weight eventually, little bit, you know. But if you're losing weight on the scales and there is not much loss in inches, then you know that you're on the wrong track.
I experienced, you know, when I started zero, there's no oil, butter, and ghee, I stopped. Then I experienced this weight is the same, but there is
the fat. Okay. So that is something to be happy about. But most people, I've even seen some doctors actually getting worried, you know. There is, oh, but my weight is the same.
Yeah, weight is the same.
The weight is the same. On they feel their body is looking toned, their clothes are fitting better,
yeah,
but still their weight obsession is there in the mind. Yeah. So they want to get into that certain weight which they feel is right for them. Okay, so body fat is light and contributes mainly to increase in inches. So body fat, even if you're losing body fat, it may not be so perceptible on the scales because it's light, fat is light. What is heavy is your muscles. Then it's like comparing 1 kilo of, you know, like you take a bag, 1 kilo of cotton and 1 kilo of iron. Iron, which is heavier? Obviously the iron. But if you see that 1 kilo bag of cotton, the big bulky, and the iron will be a compact thing. So that's exactly your difference in the weight of that fat in your body and the muscle. And fat does the same thing to your body. The more body fat you have, more bulky. So fat is the same thing. The more fat you have in your body, the more bulky you will look. So fat only adds to bulk. When people say, you know, I went to the gym and I started weight training and I started looking bulky, that's a very wrong thing that they have. Especially women always complain. Body fat, when you have fat in the body, extra fat in the body, they only make your body look bulky. Yeah? It's like that bag of cotton, because fat is that way. It has volume. But no weight. And lean body mass. Muscles are heavy and contribute mainly to increase in body weight. Muscles are compact and give you a lean look. Ideal, when you have an ideal body composition, it will make you look toned. Like for instance, you know, there are a lot of people who just walk or who just do aerobics. You will see them, they look thin. You know, after a certain period, suppose after 1 month, 2 months, but you will always see that layer of fat on their body. You will see their skin is a little loose. That's because they have lost a lot of muscle. The body fat, major part is still there. Okay, so that is how you you kind of determine, you know, if this person is following the right schedule or not. And body composition, like I told him, is 20% genetic. And 80% is something which is dependent on your lifestyle, your workouts, your diet. And people who say that, like I told you, that excuse, it's just very convenient to say that, you know. Okay, fat loss versus weight loss. Like I said, lose fat, not your weight, because beyond that 15%, then your body, if you want a toned body, then this is what you have to aim for. Yeah, I think this is okay, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, now how do you achieve fat loss? Combination of exercise, nutrition, adequate rest. A lot of people know about the first two. They don't give importance to the third one at all. This is as important, you know. But of course, after having said this, I will say nutrition, not because I'm a nutritionist, but it's a fact. Nutrition is 80%. 10% I would give to exercise, 10% to your rest.
It's like a tripod.
Rest means sleep. Your 7 hours, 8 hours of sleep every day. You know, like some people sleep 4 hours, 5 hours. They'll go work out at the gym, they eat well. Of course, their bodies will be good. But they're still not giving it the best. Because they're not, they're depriving it of that proper sleep. Because that's when your body is recovering, repairing, all the process is taking place. So if you're not going to give it enough rest, so the effect is not going to be, you're not giving it the best.
It adds to fats, you know. We don't take a proper rest.
not fat, but your, it depends again on your diet. But if your diet is good, if your workouts are good, but if your rest is not enough, your body will not develop as well as it would with a 7 hour or 8 hour sleep with proper rest.
Repairing will not be better.
Repairing, exactly. Because when you're exercising, there is some muscle breakdown happening. So that has to be repaired with adequate proper nutrition and rest, because that's when your body is going to do all its work, no, repairing work. And also, of course, I don't want to get into all this now, because that would be probably your next list. When you are sleeping after a workout, and you know, there is something called as a human growth hormone, which is released when you're at sleep. So that is actually helping your muscles to develop. Yeah. So that is the importance of you know, a good sleep. No, that is, not medical. It's a human growth hormone. It's called as a growth hormone. Okay, now which, coming to exercise. Okay, now what kind of exercise? Normally when people want to lose weight, the first thing they think of is, go start going for walks. Okay, that is a good way to start. Because you suddenly can't expect people to go to gyms and start working out. You know, they start walking. But there are some people who only walk. Then there are some people who go to the gym and they will only walk on the treadmill 1 hour, 2 hours, they will, and you see their bodies are actually becoming thinner. But like I said, there will, these people will always complain ki yahan pe fat hai, yahan pe fat hai. Why is that happening? Because you're losing a lot of muscles. When you do only cardio, na, you end up losing a lot of muscles. You want to say something? Okay, you end up losing
Yes,
it's an instant fat burner.
Okay.
Of course, you know, within a month, you will see that you've shaped up, you've probably lost a lot, you'll see the result on the scale, you'll also see physically.
Okay.
But such a person who's overdoing his cardio, you know, there are some people who work out for 1 month, 2 hours, they will do aerobics, then evening again, they'll go
even
for a walk.
Even that is dangerous for the heart also.
Heart and knees, everything. In the long run, so it will affect the knees, because you cannot go on doing that forever. But I'm talking about immediate, if a person is young, you know, in his 20s or something, he can still get away with it. But what happens, these people who over-exercise and only cardio, and sometimes they also follow a very bad diet.
Yeah.
Huh? So they want quick results.
Yeah.
So then you see such a person, you will never look.
Reduction of carbohydrates, that also.
Yeah. So such a person is, you know, that you can say a drastic reduction of his body weight or whatever. You'll see a person, such a person will never look healthy.
Right.
You'll always see his skin looks pale.
Right.
It looks kind. He has a very shrunken look. It's not a nice. People say that you look better when you were fat. You know, people always make that kind of comment because they're following the wrong things. Okay. And also, in fact, I have a lot of clients when they are coming for a diet program. They always say, I don't want to look. You know, I don't want my face to look dull. I don't want my skin to look bad. I don't want my hair to fall. And I have to assure them, don't worry. In fact, it will be better than what you are now, you know. Because they've gone to these kind of dietitians who give them those kind of diets.
Oh, I've seen in our society also, they give that kakdi diet.
Yeah.
And
all these diets,
yeah,
one day it's okay. But you cannot do it for a week, 1 month. You cannot live on
all
these kind
mineral,
of
All mineral, everything will go.
Yeah, yeah. You lose minerals, you lose muscles. So your whole body, you know, the whole look, the charm of the body goes away. People actually don't tell these people you look better when you were fat, you know. Okay, sorry, you wanted to say something?
Talk on the same thing, that exercise, it cannot be one type exercise.
Huh.
That you have to see that you improve your cardiovascular also, you have to see that you improve your muscle strength.
Exactly.
You have to see that you improve the flexibility,
exactly.
You have to see that you improve your balance also.
Yes.
So it has to be a combination.
It has to be a combination. Then you will end up looking fit, toned, and you know, a person will say, okay, you know, then people will come and ask you, what do you do, what kind of diet you follow, what exercise you do, which gym you go to. There are also people who come and ask, you know, which gym. And they feel that even if they also, if they go to the same gym, they'll get the same results. But that is the way you have to be, you know, if you're going to tackle your weight issue, then that's how you go about it. Now, when he said it has to be a mix of everything, so basically it is cardio and your weight training. You have to combine the two. I'm not saying cardio is bad. You have to do cardio because that will improve your cardiovascular endurance. You know, your heart rate, your lung capacity, everything increases. But then you cannot do only that. So if you're doing like 3 days of weight training, you do at least 2 days. Again, it depends on how much weight or how fat you are or thin you are. So it depends. So 1 day, 2 day, 3 days of cardio is a must. So at least 5 to 6 days of exercise initially. Later when you have the maintenance stage, depending on how much time you have, that could be 3 days, 4 days. You're just maintaining. Now, what does cardio do? It improves your cardiovascular endurance. What is the importance of weight training? It will increase, help to increase your muscle mass, provided it is backed by your good diet. If you're doing weight training and your diet is wrong, you'll only again end up with muscle loss. Okay? Yeah, another thing I just want to share with you is a lot of people before workout, they go empty stomach, especially when they're going to do their...
That is bad.
A lot of gyms will tell you, a lot of people who, see, gyms, obviously they're very commercial.
Yeah.
And they will cash in on your weight loss, 5 kgs in 1 month.
Oh, that is why their advertisement.
Yes.
So the ads, this period you will lose 2 kgs.
And people fall for it. People fall for it not realizing that they're being told the wrong thing. So 5 kgs in 1 month, how do you give the person 5 kgs in 1 month? It's very easy, I don't even have to go to a gym. Just go on a crash diet,
yeah.
Just keep walking, five
and maximum days. That is water reduction.
Yeah, water and muscle loss. Okay.
When you add the stretches, see some stretch exercises are
stretches
necessary
are,
because flexibility do not improve.
No, no. See, when you, before you start your workout, you have to warm up. Warm up, those warm up exercises just to get your body temperature up. Then you start your workout depending if you're doing cardio, if you're doing weight training. After your workout, you have to stretch. At least the parts which you have worked on. If you don't have time, if you're very rushed, then 5 to 10 minutes, suppose I'm doing my leg workout, then I have to do my leg stretches. You know, otherwise the muscles will be all, you know, still contracted, you'll end up with soreness and all that. If you have time, you can do your entire body stretch in 15 minutes. That's excellent. So that will help improve your flexibility a lot. But the must is that body part has to be worked. Even after, same thing after cardio also, you have to work out, stretch your body. So, the importance of cardio and stretching. Okay, now, I've been talking so much about improving your muscle mass, increasing your muscle mass. What is the importance of the muscle mass? Why are muscles important to us?
Burns fat.
Yes, very good. Did you read here?
No.
Okay.
It burns fat.
Okay. Now muscles and fat, they have an inverse ratio. The more muscles you have, the less fat. The more muscles you have, the less fat you will have. The less muscles you have, the more fat you have. Why? Because muscles are very active tissues. Okay. And they are high maintenance. So if you have more muscles, they are burning calories all the time. Even when you are sleeping, even when you are resting, your calorie burn is high. So that means your metabolism is high when you have more muscles. Very good. Okay, so your metabolism is high. Importance of increased muscle mass, it increases your BMR. Now what is BMR? That's your basal metabolic rate. What is basal metabolic rate?
You need that much calorie in a day.
In a day, that means even at rest,
you're
burning a certain X amount of calories. A person with a high BMR is burning more, so that is why that person is going to be thinner. You say, yare, he has high BMR. He has high metabolism. Why does he have high metabolism? Of course, little bit is genetic, little bit is lifestyle, little bit is body composition. They all contribute. Now, when does your BMR rise? During workouts. Okay? But again, let me just touch upon this. When you're doing your cardio, your BMR rises for that 1 hour of cardio that you're doing. When you're doing weight training, during that time, there is no increase in your BMR. After that, when you're, you know, resting or whatever, you're carrying on with your daily activities, when your muscle is now repairing itself, that is when the BMR increases. So it's like 1 hour of cardio, 1 hour of BMR increase, 1 hour of weight training, 23 hours of BMR increase. And of course, the higher, more muscle mass you have, the more it will be. A beginner cannot expect 23 hours of BMR increase. It's the more advanced you get. So that is BMR, basal metabolic rate, amount of calories your body burns even at rest. And higher the BMR, more is the calorie burn. And with high BMR, you burn calories even when you're at rest or you're sleeping. We just saw this muscle-fat relationship. The more higher the muscles, less the fat. Because muscles are active tissues. Okay, they keep burning calories, so your fat keeps getting burned. So whenever a man or a woman, you should always aim for more muscles. The minute you tell women to increase their muscle mass, they're like, oh my god, I don't want to look muscular. Which is again a wrong conception. You know? They have the wrong conception that they look very muscular. Now, those women are women who are on steroids. That's why they have those. It's not possible for women to have big muscles. Because there are no women in this audience, except, of course, she is there. Then, like I said, this is 80%. I've got some of the nice lines I picked up. These are not my own lines. See, nutrition makes you, shapes you. Okay? Abs are made in the kitchen. A lot of these times, these models always say that. Abs are made in the kitchen. That means it's what you eat.
Yeah.
You go to the gym and you do your crunches every day, you won't get six packs if your diet is wrong. Your diet has to be right. You go to the gym just once a week and do half an hour, 45 minutes of ab crunches or whatever ab exercises, you will get a nice flat tummy.
In the kitchen is a dispensary.
Yeah, everything starts from there, no? And same with the rest of the body. Nothing is as important as what you put into your mouth. And nutrition is 24/7. Now this is something I really want to harp on. There's no off period or pause button. You know when people come to me for diet, when I'm after the whole thing, I've given them the diet, I've lectured them, then they look at it and they say, for how long do I have to follow this diet? I'm like, lifetime, this thing, lifetime, I'm going to eat like this. But again, to begin with, I'm not giving them a strict diet. I'm giving them something healthy and I tell them, this is not a diet. Don't look at it as a diet. It's a healthy lifestyle that you're going to adopt.
Till the last breath, you have to.
Huh?
I said, till the last breath, they have to follow this.
Yeah, exactly. It's just a healthy eating pattern they have to adopt. It's not like I'm telling them, eat one kakadi, like he says, or eat one apple for lunch. I can understand, those kind of diets you cannot do for life. But this is, I'm giving them good, wholesome meals, you know. And still they say, oh, this, you know, that it's very, it's, I really find it amazing. And food is the best fat burner. Now, who will explain, this is a very important line. Who will explain this line to me?
The right type of food can be.
Very good. The right kind of food in the right quantities, that's also very important. The right proportion and also at the right time. You know, there are some people
who eat,
not when you're hungry, you have to eat every 3.5, depending of course on your body type.
Grazing.
Yeah, 3.5 to 4 hours. Some dietitians talk about 2 hours, it's not possible. People who are working, it's not possible for them to keep eating every 2 hours. Even sometimes,
and that will end up with vada pav.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's good for people, you know, housewives who got a maid to keep giving them every 2 hours something. And that's not proper nutrition because these people say you can eat a biscuit also. Now biscuit according to me is out. It's okay. It's okay in an emergency when you don't have anything, it's okay. But not as, you know, as a part of your diet where you're eating 2 biscuits. What nutrition is it giving me? Nothing.
Psychologically.
It's
only filling, that's all.
It's only filling, at least you feel psychologically.
Kakra is better than biscuit.
Kakra is better, definitely. Wheat. It's made out of wheat flour.
Wheat flour?
Not meda. You get wheat, you also get bhajra, you also get jawar also these days. People are, you know, they're very innovative some places.
Nachni
is also, definitely better than meda. The food is the best fat burner, that means what you eat, you don't have to starve. You have to eat, but again, what you are eating, how much you're eating, your timings, that is important. So that will itself will help you to burn fat. Now, that exercise which I told you is only 10%. Your rest is only 10%, but it's a very important 10%. You know, your exercise is stimulus. Now, see, how it's not easy for me to keep eating healthy all the time. You know, sometimes I may go off track. But if I go to the gym, I'm always very conscious. You know, you're always very conscious. It keeps you on track. You may go off track a bit, again you come back on track. You know, it kind of motivates you when you're working out. And like I told you, that 10% sleep and rest is when all your body repairing work is going on. That's when your muscles, new muscles are formed. The old muscles that are worn out get repaired. So that is the time when all this work is happening. Okay, now let's come to the micronutrients. One second, take a water.